Hi everyone, I'm Aida Nematzadeh, and my talk today is about thinking about better models for multimodal pretraining. Why is multimodal pretraining interesting? The ability to ground language to vision is useful across a wide range of tasks, for example, visual question answering. It also has real-world applications, such as generating descriptions for visually impaired. In the recent papers, we also have observed that this type of multimodal representations can help improve the performance on language-only and vision-only tasks. We also have observed similar successes in the field of NLP. One dominant approach in the field of NLP these days is to pre-train a large language model on large amount of text using self-supervised losses, and then take this pre-trained model and apply it to different tasks by fine-tuning the models on a small supervised data set. We've seen a lot of performance gain in different tasks using this approach in NLP, and this performance gain has been due to both architecture innovations and also larger data sets. One question that we can ask is whether we can take similar paradigms and apply it to multimodal data. So to do so, we need to make a few changes. For example, we cannot really use language-only corpora. We need multimodal data. For the purpose of this talk, we're going to look at data sets that include image-text pairs, where to some extent, the text in the pair describes the image. On the modeling side, we need to think about attention mechanisms that applied to both modalities. Also, we need to consider ways to pre-process images to a notion of visual tokens. Finally, we need to consider objective functions other than the language modeling loss, where we can apply them to the image modality or use them to map the image and language modalities. In the last few years, we have seen a few different papers that apply the same paradigms to multimodal data. I have listed some of the early work using this paradigm on this slide. Interestingly, most of these models share the same backbone, so they apply multimodal transformers on either image language or video language data. They do have a slight differences in the way they design their losses or pre-process their input. And more importantly, they do achieve state-of-the-art results using this approach in a wide range of multimodal tasks. I should also note that the good performance that we observe in these models are usually after fine-tuning the pre-trained model for specific tasks. So the question that I want to ask in this talk is whether this family of models, multimodal transformers, actually learn better representations. So the performance gains that we observe, is it because the models have better architecture, or is it because of the pre-training data that we use, or is it simply because we fine-tune these models on large enough data sets that the pre-training is not actually important? To answer this question, first we need to consider what do I mean by learning better representations. There are different ways to evaluate representations. In this talk, I'm going to focus on transfer learning, meaning that we pre-train a model and test it on a different task or a different data set, and also probing representations, meaning that we're going to look at the representations using a controlled data set to better understand if representations capture certain properties. But before answering this question, I want to give a high-level overview of the multimodal transformer architecture. We can consider these models as a joint encoder, where we process language and image modalities through multimodal transformers. These family of models typically apply three types of losses. The language modeling loss is applied to the language data. The image modeling loss is a similar loss applied to the image modality. And finally, the image language matching loss is a loss that is applied to map the language and image pairs that correspond to each other. We also need to consider different ways to pre-process our images and represent them as visual tokens. In this talk and most of the existing work, we process the images using an object detector, and we take the bounding box regions and use these regions as features or as visual tokens. There are other ways or architectures that we can use for multimodal pre-training. In particular, the dual encoder architecture has been used for the retrieval task, and it's been very successful. In this family of models, the language and image modalities are processed separately without any multimodal attention, which means that we can process the language and image input and cache the features and reuse them across pairs. So these family of models are easier to scale, but they don't have this notion of multimodal request attention, where the model actually learns to attend over both modalities. Another family of model is the encoder-decoder architecture, or the captioning models, where we process image and language and predict language. The multimodal transformer architecture is a bit more natural to be used for a range of multimodal tasks, and it has been the most dominant paradigm for pre-training multimodal models. So in the rest of the talk, I'm going to focus on the multimodal transformer architecture, but I will show some results where I compare this architecture with other two architectures. So going back to the question of whether multimodal transformers learn better representations, now I will talk about how we can evaluate them in a transfer learning scenario and also how we can probably representations. Most of what I will talk about today is published in two papers that I've listed on this slide. To test the model in the transfer learning setting, or more particularly in the domain transfer learning setting, we use a zero-shot image retrieval task. In the image retrieval task, we will have a sentence such as gray-haired man in black and yellow tie, and the job of the model is to rank images given a sets of images based on their similarity or match to a given sentence. When we test the model in a zero-shot setting, we use a pre-trained model and test it on a different data set. This is good because we can basically test the goodness of representations without fine-tuning, so we don't have any confound coming up to our representations through the fine-tuning process. We also will look at probing representations specifically for verbs. Concrete nouns in the images are very consistent, and we can easily see them. So if you think about an example such as apple and look at the images that I'm showing you in this slide, they are very visually similar. On the other hand, verbs are less consistent and also are less easily observable. One reason behind this is that verbs actually capture relations. So if you think about a verb such as eating, and if you consider the examples on this slide, the only reason that we can identify the verb is by considering the participants in the action of eating. There are agents in all the images eating something that is considered edible. Another way to think about it is, when we consider nouns, we can model the task as a classification problem. But to model verbs, we need to consider a structured prediction task, where we model the relationship between the verb and its arguments. So verbs are more challenging and we think are more interesting to probe the representations for verbs because they potentially tell us more about the strengths and weaknesses of our models. Going back to the image retrieval task, what the model is being tested in a retrieval setting is its ability to order images with respect to their match to a given sentence. So if you test the model given a sentence such as a person is riding a horse and the sets of images that you can see on this slide, the model can order the images correctly by only using the word horse in this sentence. As you can see, the model doesn't necessarily use fine-grained multimodal understanding capacities to understand or answer this specific question correctly. What we are interested in is to be able to test the representations for this type of fine-grained differences on the language side and focus on verbs. To do so, we think of a sentence such as a person is riding a horse as a triplet of subject, a person, verb, riding, and an object, horse in this example. Given this, we designed a probing dataset, which we call the SVO prob dataset for subject, verb, objects. In our dataset, we'll have a sentence such as a person is riding a horse with two images. One of the images matches all the aspects of the sentence, while the other image matches only two of the three components of the sentence in a triplet. So in this example, one of the images doesn't have the right verb. So we have a person standing close to a horse. And then we ask the model to classify whether given a sentence and an image, they are matched, whether the sentence corresponds to the image. So basically, we assume that the model understands this pairs of image sentence pairs if it classifies both the positive and negative example correctly. To evaluate the model, given these two tasks that I explained, we can look at the pre-trained image language classifier, which we get after pre-training our models. In other words, we can pass the image language pairs and just look at the image language matching loss and use this the value of these laws to evaluate the models for both the transfer situation and also in the probing experiments. So with that, I'm going to go back to the question that I started with. Do multimodal transformers learn better representations? And we're going to look at the transport learning scenario in a zero-shot image retrieval task, and also probing representations using this ViewProbe dataset. So I'm going to answer three questions. Whether the multimodal transformers, or MMTs for short, are better at transport learning when tested in a zero-shot image retrieval setting. Do they have fine-grained verb understanding when we test them with this ViewProbe dataset? These two questions look at the architecture of the models. I will also look at the pre-training datasets and their effect in the performance. The first set of results I want to show you is when we compare different models from the two architecture families, multimodal transformers and dual encoders, on the zero-shot image retrieval task. So on this slide, we're looking at a plot where the y-axis is recall at one, the performance on the image retrieval task, and the higher is the better. And the x-axis is the number of images in pre-training. We have different models. The blue circles are multimodal transformers, and the orange circles are models that come from the dual encoder architecture family. If you look at the green box, you see that when we train these models on the same amount of data, the multimodal transformer architecture does better. Interestingly, if we compare the performance of the United model, which is a multimodal transformer, with CLIP, which is a dual encoder architecture, the United and CLIP do they have the same performance on the zero-shot retrieval task. But the United model is trained on much less data. So the United model is trained on around 6 million image language pairs, but the CLIP model is trained on around 400 million image language pairs. This tells us that the multimodal transformer models are more sample efficient. So the fact that we can train dual encoders on larger scale maybe is less interesting if their performance doesn't really scale as we increase the number of images in their or an image language pairs in their pre-training data. We can also do the same comparison with the other family of models, the encoder, decoder, or captioning models. So there's some work where basically the authors compare multimodal transformers with encoder decoders and dual encoders. And what they find out is that the encoder decoder architecture actually performs similarly to multimodal transformer, and they both do better than the dual encoder architecture. So to answer the first question, are multimodal transformers better at transfer learning? The answer is yes, they perform better than other architectures when trained on the same amount of data. We also observe that they are more sample efficient. So now I want to focus on the second question. Do multimodal transformers have fine-grained verb understanding? To answer this question, we are going to use our probing dataset. As a reminder, in this dataset, we have sentences that are paired with images. So we will have two images. One of the images matches the sentence, and the other image matches most parts of the sentence, but doesn't match the sentence with respect to one word. So here, we're going to look at the performance of the models with respect to verbs first. And the plot, you're looking at the classification accuracy on the y-axis. Here, the random chance baseline is around 50%. The performance of the models when we test them for verb understanding, so where the examples are different only with respect to the verbs, is around 60%. The models don't do much better than the baseline when we test them for verb understanding. We can do the same tests for subjects. So here we'll have an example where the difference in images is with respect to the subject. So as you can see on this slide, you'll have an animal lazing the grass, where one of the images include an animal, but the other one includes a person, so the subject is different. The subject understanding is a bit easier for models than verbs, but it's still not great. Finally, we can do the same test for object understanding. We'll have images where the every aspect of the image matches the sentence, but for the negative image, the object in the image doesn't match the sentence. So here, a woman jogs on the beach. We'll have an image of a woman jogging on the beach and another image of a woman jogging in a different location. Object understanding seems to be the easiest for the models, so the performance is around 70%. But again, there's still room for improvement. Overall, our observation is that multimodal transformers perform around 65% when we test them using this ViewProbe dataset, which tells us that we can do much better in terms of coming up with models that learn to better ground different aspects of the sentence into images. So to answer the second question, whether multimodal transformers have fine-grained verbal understanding, we observe that they don't. They actually fail to distinguish between verbs when we test them in a controlled setting. Now I want to focus on the last question, whether the pre-training datasets impact performance when we look at the multimodal transformers in different situations. As a reminder, we can have different types of pre-training datasets when we look at multimodal transformers or multimodal models in general. Some of these datasets are manually annotated. For example, MS COCO, localized narratives, and visual genome are datasets where we have image descriptions and a person or a group of people wrote these descriptions. We also have datasets that are curated from the web, where we basically take an image and the text which is associated with that image in a web page or through alt text and use that as our paired dataset. The datasets that are curated from the web, such as conceptual captions, are more noisy, meaning that there's more chance that the language in this dataset doesn't correspond to the image. So overall, we can consider two broad categories of datasets: manually annotated dataset, which gives us cleaner data, but are smaller, and then datasets that are curated from the web and are larger, but they're also noisier, meaning that the language might not correspond to the image. We'll pre-train our multimodal transformers on these different datasets. So here I'm showing you the results for the transfer learning settings, so looking at zero-shot image retrieval. On the y-axis, you're looking at recall at one, the higher the better, and then x-axis shows you different datasets. The first observation here is that the performance doesn't correlate directly with the number of images in the datasets. As you can see, there's ups and downs, and the larger the dataset doesn't necessarily mean we will get a higher performance in the transfer learning setting. If you look at datasets that have equal number of images, MS COCO, MS COCO narratives, and visual genome in particular, you also see performance gap and variations in the performance. So here again, the number of images doesn't determine the performance of the models. Finally, if you look at datasets that exactly have the same images, so MS COCO and MS COCO narratives have exactly the same images with different language, we still see differences in performance. MS COCO models trained on MS COCO do much better than models trained on MS COCO narratives. We did investigate why this is happening, and what we find is that there's language similarity in the pre-training dataset and test actually determines whether a dataset is good for pre-training or not. And we measure this language similarity through perplexity. Another observation is when we compare datasets that differ in terms of their quality of the images or the level of noise. So here, the SPU dataset is larger, but is a poorer dataset in terms of performance in the zero-shot retrieval task compared to the open images narratives, which is a smaller. Interestingly, perplexity doesn't explain the results here. What we think is the reason behind this observation is the level of noise in the dataset. As I mentioned, the SPU dataset has more noise, which means that the language in the dataset doesn't necessarily match the images. We think that this type of noise results in poorer pre-training datasets when we test the model in the zero-shot retrieval setting. We can do the same type of experiments with our probing dataset. So study the role of pre-training dataset in verb learning in particular. I'm going to focus on two datasets, conceptual captions and MS COCO, which highlight the differences between the types of dataset we can have very clearly. Conceptual captions is a large dataset. We have 3 million image language pairs. MS COCO is much smaller. There are 100K images in this dataset. Conceptual captions is noisy, which means that the text might not match the image, but MS COCO is clean because it's manually annotated. Finally, the conceptual caption has a domain match to SVO prob, which is our probing dataset. And the reason behind that is simply because we collected SVO probs to match the conceptual captions dataset. On the other hand, MS COCO has a domain mismatch from SVO prob. So the conceptual captions dataset has two nice properties, being large and having the domain match. But MS COCO has only one nice property, which is being a cleaner dataset, so less noise in the dataset. If we take our models and pre-train them on these different datasets and test them on this SVO prob task that I just mentioned, we observe that the models that are trained on COCO do better, As you can see on this slide, the y-axis shows accuracy over this view prop, and the x-axis shows the two data sets. This is interesting because MS Coco, which is a smaller but less noisy, actually results in better representations when we test the model using this view prop data set. We did the same experiment with another probing data set called FOIL, which tests for noun understanding. And we observed that the models similarly here, the models that are trained on MS Coco actually do better than the models that are trained on conceptual captions. This tells us that the multimodal transformer models are not really robust to this type of data set noise, which is dominant in our data set these days. So to answer the last question, whether the pre-training data set impact performance, it does. Specifically, the level of noise in data sets is very important in the performance of the models. Another interesting observation is that the language similarity between the pre-training data set and the task can impact the results significantly. One final result that I want to show you is whether there is a correlation between the performance of different models on this VQA data set and the zero-shot image retrieval task. So here on the y-axis, we are looking at the SVOProb accuracy, and on the x-axis, we are looking at recall at one. And the different dots on the slide shows the different variations of the multimodal transformer architectures that we have examined. Some of these variations include different attention mechanisms, and some of them include different losses. The interesting observation here is that there's no direct correlation between the performance on the Flickr dataset and the performance on the SVOProb. And I think this is an interesting observation because it highlights whether the need for collecting and using this type of probing datasets to better understand the strengths and weaknesses of our models. To conclude, I want to summarize some of our results that I told you about today. So when we test multimodal transformers in the domain transfer setting or the zero-shot image retrieval task, we observe that the multimodal transformers are better than dual encoder architectures when trained on the same amount of data. We also observe that they are more sample efficient. However, multimodal transformers are still a struggle to differentiate among verbs. This tells us that probing for verb understanding is a great way to evaluate models, multimodal models, and better understand the quality of their representations. We also observed that cleaner pre-training data sets, even when there is a domain mismatch between pre-training and the test, are better in the types of tasks that we have looked at. This observation also highlights the need for coming up with models that are a bit more robust to dataset noise, which is very common in our pre-training datasets. Finally, we observed that the retrieval results do not directly correlate with this VQA's performance. This tells us that we need to think about and create more controlled datasets to better understand the strengths and weaknesses of our model and better understand what the representation is in these models captured. There is some existing work which we can use for probing other than the data set we collected. For example, the FOIL dataset and HICO dataset are designed to test different aspects of representations. On the video side, the REAREACT dataset is also an interesting dataset to use for probing verb understanding. But there's still a lot of work to do, and I think there's a lot of room to investigate the quality of the representations by either probing representations using existing benchmarks or creating other probing datasets. With that, I would like to finish by thanking my collaborators, in particular, Lisa and Hendrix. This work has been a very close collaboration with Lisa. I also borrowed some of her slides from our shared slide deck. And finally, I want to thank you for listening, and I'm happy to take any questions afterwards.